welcome in, welcome in. So I know the rain is moving in, but I guarantee you, you will stay dry in this building with us. So welcome into church this morning. We're so glad you're joining us. If you're here in person or if you're joining us online, we are just thrilled to have you in service with us this morning. It's always a joy and an honor when we're able to come together as one body of Christ and join in worship of our Lord and Savior. So welcome to church this morning. To get started, we do have some announcements. The first one is that we will take communion today. It is the first Sunday of March, so we are going to partake in communion. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, Brother Justin, but we have some bread and the individual cups up here. But if they still want to take the wafer prepackaged stuff, there's some in the back in the narthex. You can go grab one of those. If you're just not quite to the comfort level of taking the bread and cup up here, that is fine. We understand. We get it. If you're joining us at home, this is the great chance to go grab some Cheez-Its and Mountain Dew. Brother Justin will bless those for you in the service, and you can partake of those. If you have Cheez-Its, Cheetos, Melba Toast, whatever it is, we encourage you to join in communion with us during the service this morning. We do have some more awesome things coming up. The first one is if you walked in, and as you walk through the middle doors, turn to your left, you'll notice a big purple box back there. That box is there to draw your attention to it because our kids department, our kids ministry team, is going to have a massive Easter egg hunt. We're talking millions and millions of eggs. Miss Lori said she's going to stuff them all. No, I'm kidding. Our goal is to have a lot of Easter eggs for the kiddos to hunt, and we are asking that you please bring a dozen, which is 12. If you want to bring a baker's dozen at 13, we'll be happy to take that extra one, of pre-stuffed eggs. So get some candy, pop it into some Easter eggs, and come drop it in that box back there. I know Miss Laura will be very thankful. The fewer eggs she has to stuff on her busy schedule as the day draws near for that Easter egg hunt. But we encourage you to bring 12 pre-stuffed Easter eggs and just drop them in that box before service each Sunday. It'll be a super huge help for our kids ministry team. If you could please do that. We also have Wednesday Night Alive up and kicking. We have programming for adults, kids, and youth all going on. Adults do a Bible study in the fellowship hall. Kids are in the kids wing, and the youth are down in the youth house doing Bible studies and stuff like that. It's a great time to come, just enjoying some fellowship and really dig your roots deep in Christ. So I encourage you all to get involved in Wednesday Night Alive. I'll be up here for sure with the youth group. And the last announcement I have is that Thursday night at 6:30 is a church council meeting that'll be held in the fellowship hall. If you're not able to make it in person, but you want to join in, get in contact with Ms. Denise. We have Zoom links that we'll send you that you can click the link and join in through Zoom, and that way you can be part of the meeting that way. So lots of stuff going on in the life of our church. Easter egg hunt's coming up, 12 eggs in the back. Communion today. Let's see, Wednesday Night Alive on Wednesday, and then Thursday is going to be our church council at 6:30. Are there any other announcements I need to make?
One more, just a reminder, if you're fifth and sixth grade, our confirmation class is starting this Sunday in the fellowship hall after service. And if you're watching online, our Zoom link also will be at 10 o'clock after first service. So we'll have donuts and things to get started, fifth and sixth grade for confirmation.
All right, fifth and sixth grade for confirmation in the fellowship hall starting this Sunday. Brother Justin said there's a Zoom link available if you need it, okay? Miss Kathy, do you have something?
Yes, have it at noon. We have the home dedication for the
Okay. That's a lot of information. So I'm gonna tell you. You can come, if you want to come say it in the microphone, that'll be easier. Or I'll just tell everyone to get in contact with you.
Online. Come up here, Miss Kathy. Come tell them about Tuesday night, sir. Look at you, your lit purple girl. Come tell them.
So our Habitat news is Patty Sue and Rick Stange's house is finished, and the dedication will be this Thursday at 2 o'clock in Haskell. So if anybody wants to come to that, the Stange's are excited about getting in their house there, and that's open to anybody. That's the one we worked on as a group here too with the other churches. And then the new house for Miss Opal is not, doesn't have a foundation, but they're going to start the pre-build, and that's at 1629 South Market, and they're going to have a meal. The United Methodist Women are pitching together and doing a meal for the Ohio Northern University Group. They're a Methodist private college in Ohio that's coming to help all week. They're supposed to be here today, starting out up there, and be welcomed by the Habitat people. And they're going to be building the pre-studs and stuff like that, cutting everything. And then we're going to host them with the Cub Scouts on Tuesday night here at 6 o'clock. And they're going to make pizzas together if anybody wants to come on and say hi to them and have a slice of pizza. So I think that's everything.
Awesome.
We'll be sure to put the address on our Facebook and all that this week.
All right, so we're going to share a lot of that information on social media, so check the church Facebook page. If you didn't catch all that or can't remember all that, like I said, it's a lot of information, but some great opportunities to get involved with Ms. Cassie, with Ms. Kathy, with the UMW, and with Habitat this coming week. So I encourage you all to do that. Are there any other announcements that need to get made at this time? Seeing none, let's go ahead and pray, y'all. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the day that you have given us, for just one more day on your planet to enjoy your creation and enjoy the people that you have created to be on it. Lord, I pray this morning that as we come to you in your house, that you would still all of the outside noise, all of the outside distractions, and just allow us to focus 100% on you, because that is what worship is truly about, focusing everything we have on you, because you are worthy of our praise. Lord, I pray this morning that you would hear our praise, you would hear our prayers, and they're pleasing to you. Let's all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and join us in our first song, which is Enough.
Amen and amen. All right, kiddos, it is y'all's time to come up front and hang out. Say, Mr. Don is going to be sharing with y'all this morning. So come on, kiddos.
Cool.
Because whenever I go outside, you know, there's a dark place under the arch.
My man's got a towel.
I got to ask you a question. This is a hard question. Have you ever been tempted to do something you shouldn't do? Have you ever been tempted not to hit your, if your mom says don't hit your brother, do you do it anyway? Are you tempted to do that?
Me too. Sometimes I do that. And I get stuff
to do. How about your sister?
Yes, I want you to.
I do too.
Okay, what if there's a nice big chocolate cupcake in the kitchen? Mom says don't touch that. Do you touch it?
It's
beautiful chocolate all on top of it. Would you eat it? Would you be tempted to eat it?
Yes.
You'd be tempted? Huh?
She's
trying to make you suffer?
I don't like icing, so I can't say I would even touch it.
What's your favorite thing?
Sleeping and eating.
What if someone said you can't shoot your bow and arrow anymore? Okay.
It's a toy, not a
bonnet. This is, should I open this up? I'm tempted. Oh, should I open it up, see what's inside?
Yep.
Do you like blue? Oh, I like yellow better. How's that? Is that better?
I see red stuff.
You see red? Oh, should we open it more? Are you, I don't know if
all
I should. Should I open it,
way.
Open it more? Okay, red. I don't know if this
red
is.
No?
I don't know if I'm.
A lot of stuff.
Should I open it up some more?
Red is kind of red.
What do you think?
Next is green and red is white.
You think? Oh, you saw it. Oh, you see? Oh, yeah. Open up some more. This is like temptation to open it more and more, isn't it? Okay, I'll open it one more. Okay. There. How's that?
Green with red with white.
Should I do it one more time? I don't know if should I do it or not.
That's yes. Green.
That's green. That's. Should I open up one more time? I'm tempted. Should I do it?
Yes.
What do you think?
Yes.
How many say yes? Raise your hand if you say yes. What do you say, Roger?
Go for it.
Even if it's something bad. But that's just.
That's a zombie.
But that's just like temptation, though. A little bit. The more you do it, it finally gets really ugly at the end.
I
know it gets really ugly at the end if you're tempted to do something you shouldn't do. You know, there's someone in the Bible who was tempted. What? Jesus. Right now we're in the season of Lent. How many days is Lent for?
40.
You know how Jesus went out into the wilderness for how many days? 40. 40 days.
40 days and 40.
He was tempted 40 days.
And 40 nights.
And 40 nights by someone who was horrible. Satan, he tried to get him to do all kinds of stuff. Jesus was hungry. He said, turn these stones into bread. He said, nope. But he kept on trying to tried to tempt Jesus, but Jesus wouldn't do it. So for 40 days, we're in Lent. So I have a challenge for you. This is a hard one. If you have brothers or sisters for 40 days, you can't hit them.
That's not possible.
That's not possible. The what? No, for 40 days.
But. I would do that because I want to get my TV back.
Okay, how about this? For 40 days, you have to do what Mom and Dad says, no matter what.
Oh, that's good.
Can you do that?
I think I can do that.
You can do that.
I cannot.
You can't do that. But Jesus was tempted for 40 days and he did it.
I don't follow the rules often.
You don't follow the rules often. What is something you can do for 40 days? What's something you can do for 40 days?
Listen to my mom and also help not help my sister.
I know.
And also,
I can't eat for 40 days.
What?
Mom, wait 40 days until they're over the
hill. I got something easier. Something real easy. For 40 days, can you every night? Can you read something in the Bible? Read a Bible story.
I can read.
You can have someone else read it for you.
Oh, thanks.
For 40 days, can you read a Bible story? There's lots of Bible stories about Samson, about Moses.
I have a big Bible story that's about this thick.
Uh huh.
And it's this big.
I am going to forget.
It's pretty heavy.
If I do not forget, I will just read the same one over and over.
That's okay. Sometimes I read the same story over and over again. But 40 days. You'd be tempted not to do it, but you got to do it. Can you do it? Can you do that?
I will forget.
No, it's not. I don't want to hear the word I try. I want to say I will.
I will try.
I will try. For 40 days. Now, the thing is, I have somebody who can check on you. You know who can check on you? Right there. Each week, I'll have Brother Justin ask you if you've read a story or not.
Then people can just lie about that.
No, I wouldn't lie about it. Don't be tempted to lie.
Okay. I will attempt to remember.
Okay.
All right.
I will attempt to lie.
Okay, bow your head. Father God, Father God, may you be with each one of these boys and girls through these next 40 days. Let them not be tempted to do something that's not right. Just let them tell Satan to go away. And just be with them, let them read the Bible each day. Be with them the rest of this week. We ask us in your son's name, Jesus Christ, amen.
I can take this off now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Amen and amen. Thank you, praise team. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. I'll give y'all just a second to turn there. It's about the temptation of Jesus. Kind of what Brother Don shared about this morning. Luke 4, 1 through 13. Then Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan River. He was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where he was tempted by the devil for 40 days. Jesus ate nothing all that time and became very hungry. Then the devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread." But Jesus told him, "No, the scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone." Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. "I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them," the devil said, "because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you will worship me." Jesus replied, "The scriptures say you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil took him to Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple, and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. For the scriptures say he will order his angels to protect and guard you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone." Jesus responded, "The scriptures also say you must not test the Lord your God." When the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We know that Jesus came not just to live in the world, but to change the world. That Jesus, the Son of God, has come that the world would be forever changed. That any who would believe that God raised His Son from the dead and confesses Him as Savior would be saved. And yet the devil tries to tempt Jesus in His time in the world and in the wilderness. Fresh from the waters of his baptism, Jesus was sent by the Spirit into the wilderness. When he was hungry, the devil tried to tempt him with bread. When he was feeling perhaps alone or weakened, he was tempted with power and security. In each moment, the devil tries to shake his confidence in God. And yet his failed attempt to steal Jesus' identity is the same method which he goes about in the world today. To lie, to cheat, to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Going about trying to rob us of our confidence in God, in the providence of God, in our faith in Jesus Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus came to the world knowing that living was not enough. That living and dying and rising, he forever would change the world. He was tempted and yet sinned not, as Don and the kids have reminded us. And in the face of all of the temptation, of his body, of his eyes, of his mind, of his senses, he was tempted, but he sinned not. The devil will come to tempt us too. To shift our trust from God. Not just to tempt us with the cupcakes, and I know that temptation is real, I promise. But to tempt us, it's something much more dangerous. To tempt us into turning away from God, our Creator, our Redeemer, and Savior. For we have to remember as well that while we are living in this world, you and I are not of this world either. And that living in the world is not enough for us as Christians. In fact, we want to experience the glory of God. Amen? I don't know about you, but I want to live abundantly as Jesus talks about the abundant life. I don't know about you, but as Jesus says that I have come that my joy would be in you and that it would be complete, I want to live with joy in my life. I'm not just interested in going through the motions. Jesus confronts and combats the lies of the devil with the Word of God. His response simply is to meet the temptations of the devil with the words and teachings and wisdom and truth and power of Scripture. When tempted with bread, he says, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. We too live, brother, sister, by the Word of God, and we too are tempted and tried. Now, the temptations that we see and experience around us may look and sound a little different than some of those which we read about in the gospel this morning from Jesus in the wilderness. But make no mistake, we are tempted to be separated from God and neighbor just the same. I think about the temptation of terrorism and the fear that the devil seeks to sow into communities and nations of people. I think about the way that corporations and joblessness and debates and discussions about low wages and high taxes, both the wealthy and the poor, are divided by the lies of the devil. Make no mistake, the church has not been immune to this disease that seems to be more deadly than the virus which has spread so well the past couple of years in the world. Every day, in fact, there are messages that try to draw us out from our trust in God to some substitute. Now, I don't know about you, but I really don't like substitutes very much. And I don't mean substitute teachers. I kind of always like that. It may have been a little easier to attempt to get away with something, I have to admit, Brother Don, when the substitute was there. Particularly if I was slick enough to switch desks with somebody else and to be somebody else. That's maybe a subject for another day. I don't know about you, but I don't really like substitutes very much. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to, you know, pull up to the dairy bar and order a cheeseburger and look into the sack and there be one that was about half eaten. I don't want to substitute the whole thing, the real deal, for anything less, do you? I have a cousin that is a committed lifelong, I almost said Christian, and he is, Dr. Pepperman. I mean, I don't know if they have such thing as orthodox Dr. Pepper drinkers. He doesn't wear a suit or dress like a Mormon or have pigtails or a long beard or one of those hats, but he must be an orthodox Dr. Pepperin. As long as I've known him, and he's a few years older than me, so that'd be my whole life, he's been a committed, you know, almost hand on his heart, one on the Bible, Dr. Pepper, and he accepts no substitutes. I've eaten with him at roadside barbecues and church cover dish dinners and family fish fries and fast food restaurants all over the country. And he will accept nothing else. Many times have we gone into some kind of place and sat down and they come around to get everybody's drink order and he asks for Dr. Pepper and they'll say, oh, we have Mr. Pitt. And he says, I don't want anything. He accepts no substitutes. I probably should have called him and double dog dared him, Don, and said, I double dog, triple dog dare you to give up Dr. Pepper for Lent. Now, I'm not as committed as he is. I'll drink a Dr. Thunder, Dr. Smith, you know, Mountain Doctor, whatever you got. Anything that's close, I will accept it. I have to admit, as far as Dr. Pepper goes. But as far as my faith in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, I will accept nothing else. As far as the Word of God goes and its truth in our lives, The stories that the Bible tells to us that teach us of wisdom and community, of love and acceptance and forgiveness and strength and power, I will accept no substitute. There are plenty of other things that I like to read, but none of them are a substitute for the Word of God and its power to change lives
communities, and the whole world. In fact, the whole world has been forever changed by the Word of God, both written and living. That is the Bible and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Forever changed. Now, you may not have thought about it in this way, perhaps, and I know that spring has not quite sprung. That's the hope of Lent, the coming of spring. But if there were no such thing as change, there would be no butterflies. If there was no such thing as change, there would be no butterflies. In the life of our church, we have a vision statement authored before my time in the life of our church, but an awesome vision statement. We talk about it a lot. I try to preach and teach and, importantly, and to live the vision of our church. To be part of a strong fellowship that shares an enduring relationship with Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. That's the vision of our church. Fellowship, relationship, and transformation. Now, a caterpillar, they tell me, you see, desires something good and great. It wants to fly. It wants to lift up from the earth and to feel the wind in its wings when it finds them. It has to leave behind even the old notions of what it means even to live as a caterpillar in order to become a butterfly. Things have to change dramatically. Now, I want to take a quick quiz, and I know the hands may shoot up fast. Do you know what it's called? This big, great, big change that takes place when a caterpillar goes into a cocoon. I see a couple hands in the back. We've got a winner. We happen to have a brand new, hot off the presses, super cool Salem Blue water bottle just for you, sir. You're right. It's called what? A metamorphosis. That means a big change. A big change. Now, you may not have noticed it, but there is a lot of big change that is taking place. And I don't mean at the gas pump. I wished I hadn't even said it. I'm not a fan of this big change. There is a lot of big change that's taking place. I was visiting with one of the couples this morning just before the service, and they said to me, "We saw a couple of young ladies this week and we didn't know who they were till we figured out they belonged to you and Russell." Because of the big change that's taking place in their lives. If there was no such thing as change, Brother Russell, there wouldn't be such a thing as teenagers.
Amen.
I looked up and I saw somebody walking down the aisle this morning at children's time, and I don't think I'd seen that before. Am I right, Ace? How long's he been on his feet, sir? Okay, I'm behind. There's a big change going on in his world. He's liable to run beat and tackle her before we know it. The Bible tells us that we are to behold the glory of the Lord. I know last week was the Transformation Sunday, and we lifted up from the Scriptures the telling of the story of Jesus there on Mount Tabor, shining with the glory of God, outshining and overshadowing the law and the prophets and Moses and Elijah, that Peter, James, and John were there to witness this awesome glory. You and I, friends, says the Word of God, are beholding glory. That we are beholding the glory of the Lord. And that we are being changed. You and I are being changed into His likeness, the Bible says, from one degree of glory to another. Now, it's easy to miss one degree. Probably in the last 2 years, you might even have missed 2 degrees or three. It's easy, maybe, if you haven't seen someone very often in the last couple of years, to know or keep up with the change that's taking place. I was surprised, really, when Miss Kathy mentioned that the house was going to be blessed and opened. I remember, I guess it was just last summer, that Johnny and Joel and a number of people from our church were there framing at the house. And all of a sudden, the vision of God's apostles in our community has become a house. And when they move in and bless and pray and receive their gifts and their Bible, in the love of their presence there, it will become a home. Amen? It's easy to miss a degree of glory if we're not looking carefully enough. I want to ask you maybe, if you remember last week, was that we had a change at our church last Sunday. We had a change. We had a change, and we had a good sermon last Sunday. But I'm curious, and I wasn't here last Sunday. You see, all kinds of glory has been taking place that I have missed. It's been 2 weeks for me, you see, till I've looked out from the chancel and the pulpit to see the glory on your face. To see the children coming down the aisle and into the pews with their parents. The glory is easy to miss. I dare you to cut your eyes over to your left. If you're real bold, you can just turn and look even. Just use your whole neck and look over there. And you may notice that somebody to your left, just give them a good look there, and then I want you to say this word, glory. Just look over to your left and see who you see. Steve's already ahead of me. He's Spirit-filled. He looked left and to the right, Pentecostal. He looked both ways already. He already knows it. Glory, glory. Look to both sides, like Brother Steve. You know, Kathy, if you look, he's right there. Look at the smile on that man's face. And if you look to your right, see Roxy, she's got Larry right there. She can see his glory shining even behind that beard, right? Behind those twinkling eyes and those glasses. Her favorite Boilermaker, am I right? And to her right is her friend Paula, am I right? Look to your right. Glory and glory. Glory and glory. For some of us, you have to look, you know, across the aisle to see. In a way that sometimes we're too blind in Washington, D.C., to look across the aisle. To look across the aisle. And to see that glory is there. To be, that says beholding. That's a fancy word. I just like the word see. Pretty soon we may look and sis may be home for spring break or summer break. And she might even look different after a year away in college. Am I right? Her brother may not see the glory as quickly as mom will or dad, but and brother two's probably a foot taller than he was last summer already. He's no longer a boy, but now a man. Beholding glory. Sometimes I think we get it twisted in this season of Lent and in our hope of spring. Sometimes we let the cobwebs of our disappointment clutter not just our closets, but the edges of our hearts. If we're not careful, the winter of our discontentment will have us not even seeing the sun to rise. There truly is glory all around you. Glory, glory, all around you. It's in front of you and behind you. And the sooner I hurry up, right outside these doors. The glory of God to see and to share with one another. I confess that there have been moments in my life's journey where I have gone through the motions. I was thinking about this when I was mowing the yard on Friday and running the weed eater and pulling some weeds out and trying to yank things out and prep things up in the hope of spring. I tried to make my lines good and straight, you know, and as I was working through that yard for a minute, I probably should have called my dad and made a confession. I thought about all the times when I did it halfway. When I did it sorry. I thought about all the times when I did it just to get it done. The yard work. When I went to rake the leaves and about half of them were still in the yard when I was done. And I thought about the difference in doing something well. And doing something with all of my heart into it. With all of my mind and my soul into it. I thought about the difference even in the kind of faith that I want to live. In the way that sometimes it's little more than going through the motions. And yet there is an opportunity for me today in my heart to take just a taste of glory from God's table. To take just a snapshot from your faces. To recognize even today that three people in particular are even more glorious than they were yesterday. We have, in fact, I think three birthdays today. It's Lynn's birthday, I hope, is it, Lynn? And it's Joe's birthday, isn't it, Joe? Is it Reagan's birthday today? No, it's Shelby's birthday today. Oh, that's right. I almost forgot, Shelby. I got to look at the list. I know we have at least three birthdays today. It's Shelby and it's Charles. I remember saying happy birthday outside. Charles, where'd you run off to? I've lost sight of you. Is he in the back? It's Charles's birthday. Charles and Shelby and Miss Lynn Robinson. Who else's birthdays are this week? Patty Fullington and Lexi Smith. Randy birthday boy Mason has a birthday this week. Huh? Hey, if you're good, somebody may take you out to eat, dude. And looky here, Mason and Sawyer are going to be filling up a whole hand, aren't they? Five, that's a big number now. And your mom just had 100. Yes, sir. Tell us.
Church presented cards and the people that sent cards, and we had a big parade. We had two fire trucks.
Come on now, that's going all the way. Two fire trucks.
The mayor was hanging on the fire trucks. Had about 25 cars following. 11 fellows
cars.
So that was a great, great blessing. Yeah.
Awesome.
She's doing great.
Card. Now, whether it got there with my handwriting, that's another subject. I should have had Denise print a mailing label. That's right. That's right. What an awesome... Two fire trucks? I mean, that's next level. I've been to a kid's party with one, but not two. Transformed in glory. Sometimes it's easy, though, to miss it. The very disciples of Jesus at times even missed it, though they were right there. It's easy to look down maybe even in your life at home sometimes, and you look and maybe that old boy forgot to put the cap back on the toothpaste, you know? And if you get too focused on that, you can miss the glory. Right? You can get too focused trying to clean out your car and get the Skittles and French fries mom out from under the seats in the van and, you know, and trying to pick up everybody's shoes. And if you're not careful, you can miss the glory. I want to today to know in my heart the glory of God. I don't know about you, but I didn't get up today to just live another day, check another box. It's not my birthday, but I still want to do more than just live. More than just mark days on a calendar or watch the hours go by on the clock. More than just go through the motion of the seasons. I want to live the glory of God. And someday, like that butterfly, someday I will be truly transformed. I know it's not Easter yet. I'll give you a hint. Someday even we're all going to fly. Amen? But before we earn our wings, let us share in the glory of this simple table. And let us remember that Jesus who came to change lives, yours and mine, who came to change communities like ours and the whole world, that in the company of those disciples who caught a glimpse of His glory, that He took a loaf of bread, and as they gathered in the upper room in the last days of the week of His life on this earth, in his earthly body, that he took a loaf of bread, that he prayed a prayer and said, "Blessed are you, O Lord our God, for you alone make rain upon the earth and grain for the table and fruit to the vine." He broke the bread and said, "Take, eat. This is my body. It's given for you." As they share the simple supper, he also takes the cup, the Bible tells us, and also lifts it from the table toward heaven. And he says, "Thanks be to you, O God our Father, for you alone have made me to take away the sins of the world." And so as they shared the bread and the cup, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. And drink from this cup, all of you. This is the cup of salvation, for I make with you a new covenant." Today we gather in this place. Today we gather and share from this table and many others. And today we proclaim the very mystery of faith, the great metamorphosis of God in Jesus Christ, that Christ has died, that Christ is risen, and that Christ will come again. And so we ask for the Spirit of God to be poured out upon us, gathered here and there and everywhere, wherever you may be, friends, joining with us. We pray for God's blessing upon us all. We pray that somehow the bread and juice, the simple things that we share, remind us of the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has brought salvation to our souls and who desires to save the whole world, that one day all who call upon the name of Jesus would be saved, and that one day all of us would feast at the eternal table. For we pray these things in the power of the Holy Spirit, in the providence of God our Father, and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we prepare to share in the simple supper at this table, as we prepare, as you prepare maybe at home or wherever you may be to share, let us all simply share as well as the disciples of Christ in the prayer which he teaches us to live, to the prayer of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Russell to come with me and invite the chancel to come forward first. We'll serve first to the chancel and then invite you as you feel led and might be able to come forward and to receive of the bread and the juice. We'll have two lines for you to come forward and to spend time as you might like at the chancel. If there's anybody here that struggles with transition after everybody has come forward, we'll come to serve you in your seat. If there's anybody that has need of the self-contained wafer and juice, there's some in the back. If you missed one on the way in, the ushers can serve those to you. I see Linda Westbrook's got some right there in the aisle. You may prefer the gluten wafer, so if you wish, we have that as well. But let us share in this simple act of glory. Which way you want it? This way, then. That's what I want. Okay. not receive? Anybody that needs to be served?
Please stand for our last song, I Want a Principal Within.
Amen and amen. I want to thank you all for joining our service this morning, for being part of it, for taking communion with us. It's always just such a joy to be able to worship together. Something in the scripture that really sticks out to me this morning comes from the very, very end in verse 13 when it says, when the devil had finished tempting Jesus, he left him until the next opportunity came. So this lets us know that I'm pretty certain the devil will never be done tempting us in our life. But I want you to leave this place knowing from here on out that you don't have to worry about that anymore, because you're going to leave here changed. There's been a change in you, in your heart, in your spirit. I want you to take that change and that new confidence into the world and show Christ's love to everyone, no matter what temptation is before you. So in Jesus' name, go and share his love. Amen.
Amen.